I'd like you to turn your Bibles to 2 Samuel chapter 9. 2 Samuel chapter. I know we are on Good Friday. 2 Samuel is not the typical passage that we read on a Good Friday. But that's where I want to start off today, talking about another underdog. We've been doing a series called Underdogs, God of the Underdogs, and how God picks up unusual people, qualifies them, uses them for his glory. But this is a very unusual story, and so I want to take this time to meditate on that and connect it to the Good Friday this evening, what we are celebrating. Chapter 9, verses 1 onwards. Let me read it for you, and as I'm reading, follow along with me. One day, David asked, "Is anyone in Saul's family still alive? Anyone to whom I can show kindness for Jonathan's sake?" He summoned a man named Ziba, who had been one of the Saul's servants. "Are you Ziba?" King asked. "Yes, sir, I am," Ziba replied. The king then asked him, "Is anyone still alive from Saul's family? If so, I want to show God's kindness to them." Ziba replied, "Yes, one of the Jonathan's sons is still alive. He's crippled in both feet." "Where is he?" the king asked. "In Lodebar," Ziba told him, "at the home of Machir, the son of Amiel." So David sent for him and brought him from Machir's home. His name was Mephibosheth. He was Jonathan's son and Saul's grandson. When he came to David, he bowed low to the ground in deep respect. David said, "Greetings, Mephibosheth." Mephibosheth replied, "I am your servant." "Don't be afraid," David said. "I intend to show kindness to you because of a promise I made to your father, Jonathan. I'll give you all the property that was once belonged to your grandfather, Saul, and you will eat here with me at the king's table." Mephibosheth bowed respectfully and exclaimed, "Who is your servant that you should show such kindness to a dead dog like me?" Let me pause there. I'll come back to this passage one more time as we continue come back to look at what God wants to teach us. We are doing a series. Usually on a Good Friday and Easter morning, we don't follow a series. But this passage and this story fell in at such a great place, and I thought this would be a great sermon for us to hear. Word for us to hear on Good Friday. We are talking about how we all love underdogs and how we always cheer for underdogs. If you need a notes, by the way, we have the notes ready for you, and you just have to slip up your right hand and our host will get it to you. If you need a pen, you can still slip up your hand. They'll get it to you. Good notes to take, by the way. So just keep your hands up and they'll get it to you. Don't worry. Just keep your hand up like that. Okay? We all have reasons as to why we are not qualified enough to have what we have. We are not worthy enough to be at the place that we are in today. We all worry about how, we are not the guys who should be following what God is asking us to do. It must be somebody else who's more qualified, more smarter, more wiser, more stronger, who should be the one who would do what God is asking you at this point of time. Everybody in the Bible felt like that. When they were asked to do something by God, they felt they're unqualified. Moses felt he was unqualified, incompetent to be a leader, that he is not the guy who should be a leader. David would have felt like unqualified to be the king. And Esther would have thought, my chances are too slim. We looked at Joseph. Joseph would have said, nobody recognizes my potential, and I don't think I can ever accomplish what God asked me to do. A guy like Jacob would say, I have a very bad reputation, and it keeps following me. It keeps destroying me, and I don't think I'll ever get a chance to prove myself. They all had excuses. The thing is, we also have excuses to give to God. Logical excuses, legitimate excuses. Whether they are perceived excuses or real excuses, we do have excuses to give to God as to why you are not the guy who should do what God is asking you to do. We have a tendency to hide behind excuses and not follow God. Every great hero of the Bible had an excuse to give to God. And yet the reason they have become heroes is because they chose not to let their excuses hold them back from accomplishing what God asked them to accomplish. They chose to face their excuses head on, and they were able to become overcomers. This whole series, and we are talking about even that today, is to help you to understand this, that there are people who had excuses just like you, and yet they chose to face them and become overcomers. If we can look at them, maybe we will find some inspiration for our own life, and maybe we'll also become overcomers in our lives. So we're looking at different excuses. We talked about one excuse which says, nobody recognizes my potential from Joseph's life. We talked about my reputation is too bad last Sunday from the life of Jacob. Today, we're looking at another excuse we normally give to people. Give to God. I'm not connected to the right people. I'm really not a guy who connects with people well. I'm an inferior guy. My chances in this world are too small. My world is small. My family is small. Where I come from, people don't really get chances because nobody respects them. Nobody gives them an opportunity. I don't have the right connections. That would be one excuse we usually give. If I am being honest, there have been days along the way when I let that excuse of not being connected to the right people stop me from doing what God asked me to do. Stop me from doing this church. I almost gave up and I said, God, I don't really have good connections. I don't think I can ever see, accomplish what you're expecting me to accomplish through Capstone. Not that I've already accomplished it, but at least, I made that as an excuse to say, God, I think I'm happy with small group. There have been days that I did that. Many underdogs, people like you and me, fall victim to this very common excuse in the pursuit of our dreams. And here is the story of a guy called Mephibosheth. And I want to talk about Mephibosheth. Mephibosheth is no hero. We've been talking about great heroes of the Bible. But in the passage that we have just read, the hero is actually David, not Mephibosheth. So technically, the story is supposed to be David's story. But I want to give a counter perspective to you from Mephibosheth's angle. You would have heard the story of how David showed kindness to Mephibosheth many times from this pulpit or any other place, of how David is almost like the model of how God shows grace towards us, how God shows undeserving kindness to us. We'll talk about that also. But you heard this story from David's perspective, but I want to present to you this story from Mephibosheth's perspective. How Mephibosheth would have felt. I know you have hardly 3 verses about Mephibosheth in this entire story, the passage that we have read. It's all about David. It's all about David thinking about how should I show kindness to Saul's family or Jonathan's family? It's all about David inquiring, trying to find out if there is anybody who's alive from Saul's family and somehow manage to get them and then show kindness to them. But I want to talk about what if the story is told from Mephibosheth's perspective. But before I do that, let me just tell you something very important to you. And this would be what we want to call the big idea for today. Think about this. Take it back with you. God knows who you are and the connections you need. Remember this. God knows who you are and the connections you need. You just have to depend on Him. God knows who you are. He knows where you come from, where you are right now. He knows what you're made of. He knows what kind of people surround you. He knows exactly the kind of family from which you come. He knows that you have certain connections, you don't have certain connections. But whatever you have is exactly what God wants you to have. So you just need to learn to trust Him and depend on Him. And that's what I want to prove to you through the story of Mephibosheth. When Mephibosheth was found out where he was in the house of Machir and was brought to David's place, I always wondered what would be Mephibosheth thinking at that time. Here is this guy who was crippled. He was crippled not because he was born a cripple. He didn't have a polio or anything. He fell down when Saul, his grandfather, was is dead, and then his father Jonathan is dead in the battlefield, and the new king is going to come and establish himself as a king, David, of course. And they, the household of Saul were scared that David's men are going to come and kill them. Now, in Middle Eastern culture, and I'm sure it is also possible that it is part of our ancient culture, even in India, that if a new king comes from a different family, the first thing that he's going to do and all the people who follow him do is to find out the previous king's family, whoever is alive, and kill them, whether they are real threats or perceived threats. That means even if they're little babies, they would kill them because they don't want any threat to this king, this particular king who has become new king in the future. So they would just eliminate them. They will search for them all through the kingdom and eliminate them. The only way to live is to escape from that kingdom and be somewhere else. So when Saul's household heard that they are dead, Saul and Jonathan are dead, so David is going to now surely going to become the king, they know for sure David is going to take his revenge. Because David has been persecuted by Saul for almost 20 years. So they know David is going to exact his revenge. He's going to come with guns blazing into the house and kill everybody. So probably out of that fear, as they began to run for their lives, all the household of Saul and the servants who served Saul, as they were running, this little kid, Mephibosheth, was in some servant's hand. A servant running for his life did not really care about this little kid that is in his hand, and somehow managed to throw him down. I don't know how hard he fell. He must have fell really hard that his both legs broke. Now, I'm sure if he was in the royal palace, his legs would have been probably attended by a doctor, and maybe he would have gotten better. But chances are that since everybody is scattered, the entire family is scattered, and this little kid was in the hand of a servant who probably grabbed him by his hand in spite of the excruciating pain this little kid was going through after he broke his legs, as he ran for his life, probably trying to hide this little kid and himself, and in this process ignored to attend to the wound which permanently damaged his legs. So somewhere, in some place, Mephibosheth managed to hide all his life. We know that now, as we read this story, that he was in a city called Lodebar, in somebody's house called Machir's house. I don't know what was the condition of Mephibosheth. We don't read about what is the condition of Mephibosheth in Machir's house. But I trust. Jonathan's son, well, because they have taken care of us, and probably the servant and this guy called Machir would have taken up the responsibility of Mephibosheth, who is an invalid, and was taking care of him as one of his sons. Could be possible. That's one. That Mephibosheth had a comfortable life in Machir's house. But there is also another possibility. The other possibility is this, that now I don't have to give an answer to the king, because King is dead, Saul is dead, Jonathan is dead. We don't really have to take care of this this guy. And anyway, he's an invalid. Why don't you just leave him alone or make him a servant in our house? That's another possibility. That Mephibosheth would have ended up as a servant in the house of the servant who served him before. That could be a possibility. Or there could be another possibility that they would have said, anyway, this guy's invalid. Let's just put him in one room and lock it up. And maybe that's where he will be safe, and left him there every day, give him some food, and he'll just live like a dog. I have a feeling that's what his condition was. Because somehow he managed to grow up thinking that he's a dog. I'll come to that. That he lived in that room, probably hiding because of the fear of David coming and killing them, or David's men coming and killing him. Inside that room, probably every day, just getting little food and managing to live as he was. In a world, something like that, you would feel completely forgotten. And I feel Mephibosheth would have felt like completely forgotten by everybody. I want you to understand, by the time David sat at his breakfast table, because Bible does start off saying early in the morning when David was at his dining table. So that means he's having his breakfast and then remembered Mephibosheth or a house, you know, somebody from the household of Saul and Jonathan. Till David remembered Mephibosheth, Mephibosheth's life was completely forgotten. Nobody cared about him. Nobody would have thought about him. He may, in fact, be more happy to be forgotten because at least he's safe, you know, in some place. Nobody cares about him. He's at least safe there. Being left alone, content with his anonymous life. What he didn't know is that someone else did not forget. Someone else did not forget the promise that he made to someone else. And he wants to fulfill the promise that he made. That Mephibosheth didn't know. He probably felt absolutely forgotten. This evening, chances are, some of you are in Mephibosheth's state. That you walked into this place absolutely forgotten by your own family. They stopped inquiring about you after you've become a Christian. They threw you out of your home. They excommunicated you and you began to live your life on your own. You just didn't want to leave God. You probably hung on to your faith in Jesus. But as the years passed by, your faith in Christ is also going low down because you feel forgotten. You hoped that somehow some miracle would change your family and they would get back to you. They forgot. It looks like God forgot. It looks like you are the only one living all alone on the earth, absolutely forgotten. Feeling that we are not connected to the right people doesn't mean we are forgotten by God. Remember this. This is the first thing that I've learned from Mephibosheth's life. You are not forgotten. You are not forgotten. You may feel like that you've been forgotten. You may feel like because you don't have the right connections, nobody cares about you, nobody pays attention to you. And so that's where you are. You are not forgotten. Because unknown to you, something else is happening behind the screen. Let me take you to the background story. Why did David do what he did? Why David has to do the thing that he has done, looking for somebody from Saul's household or Jonathan's household to find them so that he can show kindness? Of course, we find the first reason. The first reason is that David wanted to fulfill the promise that he made with Jonathan. Bible calls it, David made a covenant with Jonathan. Of course, that's one reason, because he made a covenant with Jonathan. In our culture today, the idea of covenant is largely forgotten. Let me explain that to you. In this world right now, nobody talks about covenant. We talk about contract. Right? Am I right? A contract for house rentals, a contract for, you know, any rental that you're going to make, or just like how we made a contract with Lemon Tree, that, you know, things like that. We make contracts now. We don't make covenants. Let me explain the difference between those two. A contract, we make a contract with somebody because we don't trust that guy. What if you don't keep up your end of bargain, you know? So let's put that in words, so that I follow my rules, you follow your rules, let's just be this, you know? This paper binds us together in this contract. So because we don't trust people, we form a contract. But a covenant is completely different. A covenant is made with somebody you trust. There are no papers, there are no signatures, nothing like that. It's just on the trust basis. And that's the kind of covenant that David and Jonathan made. When David was in a place of disarray, he was running away from his father-in-law, who's trying to kill him, apparently for no reason. David had no clue why Saul wants to kill him. In fact, Saul is his father-in-law. He married Saul's daughter, right? So he must respect him. And instead of that, David is being pursued to be killed. Saul, because he reasoned that if David is alive, Jonathan is never going to become the king. And in fact, my own throne is in danger. I might as well kill this little kid. So David is running for his life, not knowing what to do. Jonathan comes and finds him hiding in some bushes late in the night. And they both begin to talk. And David says, I don't know why your father is trying to kill me. Would you like to find out why your father is trying to kill me? Jonathan says, all right, I'll find out. Don't worry. Just stay put here. Let me go back to my father. My father is throwing a party. And let me just find out there. So he goes into the party, finds out through Saul's anger that Saul wants to kill David because Saul doesn't wants Jonathan to become the king. So Jonathan comes back and tells David, David, I'm sorry, this is the reality that my father wants to kill you. And there's nothing I can do about it. But I want to do something with you. He takes off his robe, puts it on him. Takes off his sword, gives it to him. Takes off his belt, gives it to him. I'll come to that. And then he makes a covenant with David. In 1 Samuel chapter 20, verses 14 to 17, you'd read a covenant that David and Jonathan made to each other. Jonathan is talking to David, and this is what Jonathan is saying. Show me unfailing kindness, like the Lord's kindness, as long as you live, as long as I live, so that I may not be killed. This is Jonathan talking to David, whose life is in danger. David's life is in danger, but Jonathan is talking to David and he's saying, don't kill me, David. Because Jonathan realized one thing. No matter how much my father tries to kill him, David is going to become the king. And so Jonathan tells David, David, one day you will become the king. And when you become the king, show me the kindness and don't kill me. Do not ever cut off your kindness from my family. Not even when the Lord has cut off every one of David's enemies from the face of the earth. In other words, Jonathan is saying, even if God is killing everybody in my family, you don't kill me. You don't do anything to my family. And David, the fugitive who is running for his life, hears these words of encouragement of Jonathan and then turns back to him and hugs him and says, okay, I'm going to make a covenant with you. One day I'll show you kindness. And that's what he remembered here after 10 years after he's become, more probably 10 years after he's become the king, as he sat down at the table, he suddenly remembered, I made a promise to Jonathan. I know Jonathan is not around. I know Saul is dead. I'm sure nobody from Saul's family is alive. But let me still find out so that at least for Jonathan's sake, let me show some kindness because I made a promise to Jonathan. So he goes searching for him. Probably he found out a guy called Ziba served Saul's household. So he called Ziba and asked Ziba, since you were serving Saul's household long back when Saul was alive and Jonathan was alive, do you know, is there anybody who's alive from their family? And Ziba says, yeah, but I'm not really sure, should I tell you or not, kind of mind. And then finally, when he hears David's words, when David says, so that I can show kindness to them, he would have felt relieved, thank God. He's not trying to kill him. So he tells him, there is one guy who's living. But anyway, he's a crippled guy. He is living in somebody's house called Makir. So David goes and searches for him and brings him home. So one reason, because David made a promise to Jonathan. But I think this is the main reason. The second reason is the real reason. Because Jonathan showed absolute generosity to David. Jonathan showed what grace looks like to David. In the act of taking off his robe and taking off his sword, taking off his belt and giving to David, Jonathan actually showed what great grace and generosity, kindness should look like. From 1 Samuel chapter 18, let me read that for you. Verses 3 and 4. Jonathan and David have become the king, friends, thick friends. This is after David killed Goliath. Jonathan recognized this guy is future material. And I want this guy on my side or I am on his side. Something should happen. So he goes to David, makes friendship with David. And this is what he says. Jonathan. This is what Bible says. Verses 3. Jonathan made a covenant with David because he loved himself, because he loved him as himself. Jonathan took off his robe that he was wearing and gave it to David, along with his tunic, even his own sword, his bow, and his belt. Now, you may not really give big importance to this verse, but in ancient culture, this is a very big thing. Especially when it comes to royal families. This is like transfer of power to others. This is like saying, I recognize you are king. So I'm giving you my robe, my royal robe to you in recognition that you are true king. I'm giving you my sword in act of surrender that I will never lift up my sword against you. That I'm taking off my bow and giving it to you because this is my way of telling you that I'm not going to fight you. In fact, I'm going to fight along with you. In the act of taking the belt that would almost symbolize the royalty, takes it that gives it to him, saying that, you know, now we don't really care about our belts, right? But in those days, when you give a belt, it's a symbol. It's like power transfer. And gave it to David. Mind you, David is nobody at that point of time. The one thing that David achieved in his life at that point of time is killing Goliath. That's all. He has not done anything with his life. He's a kid. His own father didn't care about him at that point of time. His own brothers mocked him at his audacity to say that I'm going to go and fight Goliath. So nobody really paid attention to David. Here is one guy who's looking at David when nobody cared, walked up to David and said, I recognize you're king. And I know one day you're going to be, he may not have said that, but in the act of giving the robe and the tunic and the sword, he is saying so. I'm sure that act would have been life-changing experience for David. If he was doubting his own ability up to that point, that action would have changed him completely. Personality would have changed. David's personality at that point of time, I'm sure, would have changed, you know, took a complete new turn. If it was somebody else, another commander, another soldier, if it was his own brother, things wouldn't have changed much for David, but it was the son, the king's son who walked up to him and said, I recognize you as the king. That act changed David. It was an act of kindness. It was an act of generosity. It was, David did deserve it, but Jonathan did it. And I think that's that kind of imprinted upon David's heart so much that he said, when he became the king, he said, I have to show this back to somebody. So much generosity I've experienced in my life. When I was nobody, somebody showed me generosity. When I was struggling with problems all around me, pressed, crushed, somebody believed in me and believed in me enough that in the midst of my struggle, they made a covenant with me saying that one day you will become the king. When you become the king, I'll come and serve you. Or David needed to hear that and somebody gave him that. That, I think, would have been inside David's hearts up to that point. That as he sat down at the dining table, he recognized, I'm here because somebody showed me grace. I'm here because somebody showed me generosity. Somebody showed kindness in my life. And I have to respond back. I can't sit quiet. I have to do something about this. And so he responded back in trying to find out anybody from Jonathan's house. He didn't have to, but he knew this would be a great way to respond back to the kindness shown to him. So there could be somebody like David in your life. You may feel completely forgotten, but God already has a David in your life who is thinking about you, who is saying, I've got to find out this guy and I have to repay him. You may not know that kind of person exists. Or you could be like Mephibosheth thinking that David never shows me kindness. Could be possible that it is God who's preparing David in order to tell you, no, I've not forgotten you. You are not forgotten. I'll tie it back to Good Friday today. I'll tie it back to the theme. Just keep that in your mind. The first thing that I've learned is this. We have not been forgotten. You're not forgotten. Number two. The second thing that I've learned from Mephibosheth's life and what happened to Mephibosheth is this. That your connections are God-designed. Your connections are God-designed. I don't know if you remember a few months ago, I talked about how early in the beginning of my ministry, somebody gave me a suggestion that, hey, if you want to grow and become successful, you need to have right connections. Why don't you start making friends with people in high places so that, you know, you can become a big shot? Thank God I didn't hear him, by the way. But you know, I told you about how much it impressed me and how much I thought, okay, I need to have right people, right connections. And it didn't make sense to me at that point of time because the Holy Spirit thankfully covered my heart and said, no, don't worry about it. I'm there to take care of you. But if there is anything that I've learned as I grew, every connection that we make is God-designed. Everyone who walks into our network, if you are pursuing the will of God, everyone who comes into your life is a God-sent person. At some point, they are going to play a very crucial role in changing your life. Your connections are God-designed. Remember that. Let me just take you back to that scene right now at David's household. Mephibosheth thought he's forgotten. Nobody cares about him. Somehow David came to know where Jonathan is. And David's men walk into Machir's house and find out where Mephibosheth was and tell Mephibosheth, David wants to see you. Think about this. If you were Mephibosheth, what would you be thinking at that point of time? Now let's take a few more steps back. What would you be thinking up to then? And then what would you be thinking at exactly the time when they told you, David is calling for you? Up to that point, let's come to that, up to that point. What would Mephibosheth be thinking? And you and me, if we were Mephibosheth, if I was Mephibosheth, this probably was what I was thinking about myself. Number one, I'm utterly worthless to society. because my legs don't work. I can't even stand on my own feet. In fact, I'm left alone in this room every day, given this two morsels to eat and survive. This is what I am, dog. I can't do anything on my own. I have to depend on everybody all the time. I'm worthless. I don't even think I'm useful for anybody. I'm sure Mephibosheth thought about it. Or maybe he felt that he's born in the wrong family. I'm here where I am right now because, man, my grandfather is a useless fellow. We may not say that directly. Some of us think like that. Wrong family. I wish I was born in Ambani's family. I mean, I would have had everything that I wanted. I don't know why I have to be born in some godforsaken village in Kerala. By the way, I'm not from Kerala. I would have loved to be there. But I don't know where I'm from. You know, some of us think like that. I come from a wrong family, wrong location, wrong society, wrong religion. Everything, you know. Everything is wrong about my life. And I'm sure Mephibosheth would have felt, because the wrath of God upon Saul's family is really bad. Absolutely everybody from Saul's family is abolished from the face of the earth, except for this guy. All his life, as he grew up from the time he was born, the one thing that he would have known or been told is how bad his grandfather was and how good David was and how this bad villain grandfather, your grandfather, tried to kill this wonderful king, great guy. Man, you will feel sick about your grandfather, isn't it, when you're growing up? Oh my God, these guys just are at it again. And he would have grown up with that sense of, I wish I was not born in this family. I wish I was somebody else's kid. Some of you, when you hear stories of how some other person's father is so good, so great, he would always take care of them. He was there every time they needed them. He would be there to make sure that they have good education and, you know, all that. And you compare your father with their father and you're thinking, I wish I had somebody else as my father. Mephibosheth. Maybe he felt like a throwaway, you know. As I told you, the one thing that could have happened probably to Mephibosheth all his life would have been thrown into that room, given some food. Stay there, man. Don't come out. Maybe because there's nothing else anyway you could do. Like a person who is, because he's worthless, thrown away. It could be possible that some of your family members actually threw you away, saying, anyway, you're useless. Why do you want to be here? Living almost in a refugee state, you know. If I can call Mephibosheth a refugee, he is refugee. Living in almost a refugee state, fugitive state. Now, when the David's men come and find Mephibosheth, he must be thinking, my time is up. I thought I was good at hiding. I thought I was under nobody else's radar, you know. I was hiding and I know I'm not doing anything. At least I was safe. Then when David's men found him and asked him to come along with them or to be taken along with them, this probably was what he was thinking as he's come into the palace of David. They found me. I'm dead. I'm dead. Well, in fact, David is going to kill me. Because David never got an option of revenge. Did you know that? David never got an option to take a revenge on Saul's family. So Mephibosheth probably is thinking, now David is going to take revenge on me. He himself is going to kill me. Fear in the presence of David. I know the translation that I've read says that Mephibosheth bowed down respectfully, but actually if you read NKJV or KJV, it would actually put that in perspective, that Mephibosheth bowed down in fear. The fear inside his heart is so much for his own life. And maybe he felt relieved, you know, at least I'm going to die right now. But what David said is absolutely contrast to what should have happened there. David says, don't be afraid. David said to him, verses 7, chapter 9, verses 7, don't be afraid. I will show you, surely, I'll show you kindness for the sake of your father, Jonathan. I don't know whether you deserve it or not, but I know your father deserves it. So for your father's sake, I'm going to show kindness to you. I don't care who you are. In fact, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to restore all that you got, all that it was yours, all that was yours, and maybe somebody else took it, all that your grandfather had. I'm going to restore all that and give it back to you. And here is what I'm going to do. I'm going to invite you to come into my palace and stay with me, and you will eat at my table every day for the rest of your life. What a grand gesture, isn't it? But nothing went into Mephibosheth's head. I can give you a guarantee on that. If you and me or Mephibosheth at that point of time, I don't think we would have heard a single word. The fear for our life is so much, we wouldn't have heard a single word that David said. Sometimes we don't really hear what God is trying to tell us, you know. Now, let me pause there. I'll come to that point a little later. But let me pause, tell you something, and then move on to the third thing that I've learned. Where we come from, to whom we are born, the connections we have are in the hands of God. You may think you're from wrong family. You may think that you came from wrong household, wrong village. You may think the people that are around you really don't are going to help you to grow up. But I want you to know, where you come from, to whom you are born, every single connection you have right now in your life are in God's hand. They are God-designed connections. God knows who you are and the kind of connections you need at this point of time. Our job is to trust Him. He's been working in your entire life to position you in the same place that you are in right now. This is the right place where you are. You may not think it is the right place, but it's the right place. Now, the third lesson that I want to teach you, I'll come back to Mephibosheth one more time. The third lesson that I've learned, the truth that I've learned from Mephibosheth's life is this, that you have more value than you realize. You have more value than you realize. So David said, hey, I'm going to show you kindness for your father's sake. I'm going to restore all your property. I'm going to, in fact, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to invite you into my palace, and you're going to stay with me. You're going to eat with me every single day. Whenever I'm here, you're at my table. Like every one of my sons, you're going to be here for the rest of your life. I told you David, Mephibosheth didn't hear anything. Because I know that because what Mephibosheth said next. Mephibosheth is saying this. He still bowed down, huh? Mephibosheth bowed down and he's saying, what is your servant that you should show, you should even look at a dead dog like me? In that question, or in that remark, there is an astonishment. If Mephibosheth did hear David's words, there was an astonishment, maybe thinking there is a trick here. Hey, too much of goodness here. There must be some catch here. You know, sometimes that's why we find it so hard to believe that a God can come down to this world and die on the cross. I mean, especially when we look at ourselves in the mirror, we're thinking, nah, I don't think God can come for a guy like me. That's not going to happen. You must be joking to say that, exactly like Mephibosheth. So he's saying, I'm a dead dog. Why do you want me? David wanted Mephibosheth to know that, hey, once upon a time, your dad and me were the thickest of friends. We're like the best of friends, you know. In my Facebook page, only your dad, nobody else. In your dad's Facebook page, only I am, nobody else. And we would tweet to each other, we would chat, you know, chat, WhatsApp, nobody else except for you and your dad and me. That's how close we are. We were thickest of friends, really, really, really close. In fact, your dad put his life online for my life. He knew your grandfather would get really angry, your grandfather would get really angry if he saved my life, and yet he chose to save my life. I am indebted to your father. My life is a gift from your father. That's what David is trying to tell him. My life is a gift from your father, so I want to respond back. I want to do whatever I can possibly to help you. Mephibosheth couldn't get past himself. In his answer, in his question or remark, I don't know what it is, Mephibosheth is saying he saw himself as an underdog in the most literal sense. I don't deserve anything that is being shown to me. I don't even think I should believe what is being told to me. I don't think I should believe in this. I know I'm here in a Good Friday service, but I still don't think God can do this for me. I mean, why would God love a guy like me? I mean, look at all the things that I've done. I mean, he was good. He has given me all that I've got, and yet I break his law consistently again and again and again and again, even though I'm here because my mother asked me to come to church. I'm sitting here and I'm thinking, I don't deserve it. Like Mephibosheth. I'm a dead dog, you know. That's what he said. He called himself a dead dog. In fact, the society around him saw him as a throwaway, a nuisance, a nothing. And probably that's how he began to grow, think about himself as he grew up. The thing that happened next is something that really made me understand how much God values us. Look at what David is saying. David didn't answer his question. I don't know if you realize this. That by the time you come to verses 9, David is not even attempting to answer the question of Mephibosheth. Why do you care about a dead dog like me? Look at what David is saying now. Verses 9. Then King summoned Saul's servant, Ziba. He didn't even bother to listen to Mephibosheth. He didn't even bother to, you know, turn to him and talk to him. He turned to the other servants and said, hey, get Ziba, the guy who told me where Mephibosheth, get him here. And he's saying to Ziba, I've given your master's grandson everything that belonged to Saul. Now, mind you, Ziba is not serving Saul's household anymore. Did you see that? Ziba is not serving. But David is telling Ziba, remember this. Mephibosheth is your master now. And then he goes on to say, in that word, if you are Mephibosheth and if you are sitting on the dining table and listening to David talking to Ziba and saying, Ziba, when you are sitting there and thinking you are a dead dog, David is talking to Ziba and he's saying, Ziba, look at this guy. He is your master. Can you imagine what's happening in Mephibosheth's mind? This guy who thought about himself as nobody is being told by the king, the most powerful king on the earth, that you got value, man. In fact, I don't want to qualify your question. Let me show you how much I value. He calls Ziba and says, this is your master. I'm going to give everything that belongs to his household, Saul. I'm going to give it to him. This is what you're going to do. You, Ziba, and your children, for all your life, as long as Mephibosheth lives, you're going to serve him, take care of his life. You're going to take care of his properties. You're going to make sure he's being fed well. You're going to make sure his family is taken care. Everything is your responsibility. Mephibosheth, you don't have to do anything. Just sit here, eat whatever I give you. In moments, you know, David changed this underdog and his life and his status completely. Complete rights of a sonship now, forever. So Mephibosheth, verses 11, ends like this. So Mephibosheth ate at David's table like one of the king's sons. The guy who thought he was a dead dog is now the king's son. That's what Good Friday is all about. For no other reason we come here. We come here and worship God because that's exactly what happened 2,000 years ago on the cross. We thought we were dead dogs. We thought we were worthless. We thought we come from a wrong family. We thought our life is too messed up, too wrong, too far away. In one action of taking up the cross on behalf of you and me, Jesus changed everything. Everything. A dead dog now sits at the king's table and is considered as one of the king's sons. You and I aren't much different from Mephibosheth. All of us have been born into this human race and this sin thing is in all of us. Truth is, because God is a just God, the human race deserves to be eradicated. You and me deserve to die. Just like Saul's family. But Jesus came into this world so that you and I, the dead dogs, the underdog sinners, the guys who don't deserve anything, who probably are more satisfied with this mediocre life, to tell you, saying, hey, I'm going to bring you out of your hiding places into the palaces. Jesus came so that you and I could be treated now as sons and daughters of the king for the rest of our lives. Yeah, I'll jump to Jonathan and David's conversation, because I kind of feel Jonathan is such an archetype of Jesus, huh? Classic example of Jesus. And what Jesus did on the cross is what Jonathan did to David, by the way. What Jesus does in all of our lives is what Jonathan did to David. And Jesus did a little more than Jonathan, of course. David had a friend in the Prince of Israel. You and I have a friend because of this day. You and I have a friend in the King of Israel. The King of Kings. Has he not made a covenant for you, on behalf of you, with the Father? Among his final words that Jesus uttered to his people, Matthew chapter 28, verses 20, he says, I am with you always, always, till the end of age. He made a covenant with you and me. Even though you feel that everybody is forgotten, I want you to know that I am actually with you right now, here, with you. And I will be with you as long as you live. I'm around you. Always. Has he not clothed you just like how Jonathan took out his robe and and put it on. He offers you white garments. If you read the book of Revelation, it describes so beautifully in Revelation chapter 3, verses 18, the white garments so that you may be clothed and the shame of your nakedness may be covered. All that shows you as a dead dog is covered by the robe that Jesus offered to you. In fact, he outdoes Jonathan, Jesus. He not only clothed us with clothes that would suitable that are suitable to be in heaven and to be in the family of God. He not only gives you robe, he in fact took your rags and put on himself. God made him who had no sin, Paul says, to be a sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Like Jonathan, he equips you. You are invited to put on the Lord's armor so that you will be able to stand against any strategies and tricks of devil, Bible says. Like Jonathan protected David, Jesus vows to protect you. In John chapter 10, verses 28, Jesus says, I give them life, eternal life, and they will never perish. You will never perish. No one can snatch you away from me. Maybe you have often considered yourself unworthy, like Mephibosheth. Maybe you feel like I'm even eligible to come into the presence of God and sit at the table of God and be part of the table of God. Maybe you've been tempted to count yourself out, write yourself out. You're no different from Mephibosheth. Just like how Mephibosheth felt, you felt, and I understand that. But the truth is this, a king came to the earth so that you could be redeemed and connected back to him, so that you could be seated at the table of God forever. My prayer is that you would change that mindset. I'm a dead dog. I don't deserve anything. I'm unworthy. I don't think my life is ever going to better. Don't think that. Good Friday should change everything. Everything that particular mindset says. Good Friday is a reminder to you and me this. You have a Jonathan and you also have a David. A Jonathan who comes and offers everything in Jesus. Jesus like Jonathan who offers everything to you. And like David, who brings you to his table and makes you sit. Knowing who you are in the sight of God and how you have been redeemed, if you can understand those, it has the power to change your life. Today you could walk away from here hearing the story of Mephibosheth and how a dead dog's life is transformed completely into what he has never expected in his life and say, well, that's one story. Or you could choose to accept that such grace that is offered to you through the cross and be redeemed. Experience the power that can change you forever. May you live. May you receive and live in the reality of the magnitude of God's grace, of the kind of connection that you're going to make when you allow Jesus to come into your heart. If there is one here who has never accepted Jesus Christ, you're here as a guest, you just walked in, or maybe you're a Christian all your life, you've been part of this church, but never actually allowed a connection with God because you felt too unworthy to make a connection with God. Don't go back like that. It can be changed today here on this Good Friday. Because the day that the world looked at as the most horrible day, the most gruesome act of human indignity was committed on Jesus. That day, Jesus changed it. God changed that into a day of salvation, into a day where every dead dog can be given life, an eternal life. So it's your choice today, and I invite you to make that choice. Accept it. I mean, and thank God, Mephibosheth didn't say, I don't deserve it, let me go back to Machir. I'm really glad Mephibosheth said, well, if so much grace is given to me, I might as well accept it. And there he lived. You know, sometimes so much grace can make us feel overwhelming and you feel, I'll do something else some other day. Don't do that. Be like Mephibosheth. Accept it. Today is a good day. Start at the king's table. Let's close our eyes.